coming up. So how do we reinforce the exercises you do? We're going to start with introductions. By the end of introductions, we may push out some chairs and come closer. Mark, would you like to introduce yourself as my co-facilitator?
All right, co-facilitator on this flight. Mark Thomas from USA, California, Open San Francisco Bay Area.
Who's also been offering this material for some time.
Oh yeah, I kind of offered the transpersonal, trying to bring transpersonal element consciously into workshops. Yeah. We know because ABP started a lot with a combination of like a Quaker influence and humanistic psychology. And so a lot of two of the people I use a lot is like Abraham Maslow and Roberto Saggioli, because they were a branch of humanistic called transpersonal. So they just both believe we have a higher realm. We're not just biological mechanisms. We have more, we have a potential that we can develop. So that's kind of the point of it. And then there, Saggioli brought in the specific exercises you can do to enhance that. And actually a lot of it's a modern version of the ancient wisdom you found in the Himalayas. But that you have a self and you can develop. That's not, you can change things.
And we'll hear more about that when in his meditation. So he'll lead a guided meditation. And then I have just a little information on four types of meditation that have been shown to develop really healthy brain connections. MRI shows these are a good idea. And then we'll do a brainstorm for all of us. What are the ways, what do we think helps us to reflect on exercises, how do we do debriefings and gatherings that really help the group go deeper. And then for closing, we'll just do one thing I will take away from this workshop. Okay, so we'll start with introductions. I'm Nancy Shippen from Massachusetts, USA.
I'm Carolyn from TGCC from New York.
Big Hardy Bob from Canada.
Dot Dobbins, Enduring Dot from Nashville, Tennessee, USA.
Shining Shoe of Norway.
Temple Sylvester, Nevada.
I'm Tenacious Terry from ABP USA, Minnesota.
From the U.S.
From Indonesia.
Upcoming with that from Rwanda. Edwin Asia from Germany.
Thank you. And no more people? Do we want to pull the circle tighter? Let's leave like two chairs. And
Peaceful Peter from Kenya. I live in a city called Mombasa.
Mm-hmm. 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 All right. Are you there?
bear start?
We're brave, we'll try.
I hate to have a meditation.
Yeah, guided meditation one.
But I think as people come in, we'll just ask them to sit and not do introductions till after the meditation. Mm-hmm. Is that okay with them?
How are we going to handle the translation?
If you just pretend like it's a running water in the
background. No, it's okay. I'll just think. No, I pause anyway. So I'll pause and then you can tell them what we're doing
okay.
as we go along. Because what
I am noticing here something about translation. Most of the time it's fairly easy unless it gets too fast. But both of you talked about very complicated ideas
mm-hmm.
and then went to another thing. And when the idea is a little complicated and you have multiple second languages, let alone translation, pausing after a big idea is helpful.
Thank you. And please, if you think it may be too fast, wait.
So what we're going to do is... first, a breathing meditation that kind of just grounds us in our body, kind of basing it on Thich Nhat Hanh's meditation, and then do a visualization meditation called Blooming Lotus or the Blossoming Rose or whatever flower is your favorite flower, and then do a little of Sagioli's techniques for developing self-awareness. Okay, see yourself comfortably so you can breathe easily. Let's try taking some deep breaths. So what I'm going to do is I'll be making statements like breathing in. And then I'll make a statement. And so about the count of five, breathe in, pause, and then I'll say breathing out something and pause. But what you're gonna do is you're gonna breathe, but you're gonna repeat mentally what you hear me say. Breathing in, I know I am breathing in. Breathing out, I know I am breathing out. Breathing in, I know I am breathing in. Breathing out, I know I am breathing out. I know I am breathing in. I know I am breathing out. Breathing in, I am aware of my body. Breathing out, I relax my body. Breathing in, I am aware of my body. Breathing out, I relax my body. Breathing in, I am aware of my body. Breathing out, I relax my body. Breathing in, I smile to my body. Breathing out, I relax the tensions in my body. Breathing in, I smile to my body. Breathing out, I relax the tensions in my body. Breathing in, I smile to my body. Breathing out, I relax the tensions in my body. Breathing in, I am aware of my emotions. Breathing out, I calm my emotions. Breathing in, I am aware of my emotions. Breathing out, I calm my emotions. I pay attention to my thoughts. Breathing out, I let them go. Breathing in, I am aware of my thoughts. Breathing out, I let them go. I bring healing to all parts of myself. Breathing out, I breathe out healing to all others. Breathing in, I breathe in healing to all parts of myself. Breathing out, I breathe out healing to all others. Breathing in, I breathe in healing to all parts of myself. Breathing out, I breathe out healing to all others. Visualize yourself taking a nice, relaxed walk through a peaceful garden. It is warm and pleasant. Fragrance of sweet flowers in the air. You are moving along peacefully. Attracted to a bush of flowers, a type of flower that is beautiful and attracts your attention. And on this bush, you see a flower that is only beginning to open. Green coverings are still apparent. The sunlight strikes the colors that are beginning to emerge as the petals unfold. And you gaze upon the flower as it opens, slowly, petal by petal. Brilliant colors, nice fragrance. But you are attracted to the center of the flower. The center of the flower calls for your attention. Consciousness moves towards it. And at the center is the presence of wisdom, compassion, closer and you see a power coming forth from within. It is a power that can change negativity into positivity, ill will into goodwill. Into health, with transforming power. And further you move into the center of transforming power, that you are part of it. Power flows through you, all the petals of the flower, the transforming power flows through and gleams out into the world. It's as if the flower and the transforming power are the core of what you are. A power that can change the negative into the positive, the harmful into the helpful, violence into nonviolence. You breathe it in and out. Power to all beings, north, south, east, west, above and below. From the center of peace and power, it is easy for you to look upon and be aware of the many aspects of yourself, your many identities and roles, your body, and say to yourself, I have a body, and become aware of your body, the sensations it's experiencing, the feeling of the chair. So you are physically in the chair, but you are also the center of transforming power. You relax the body. You have a body, but you know that you are more than the body. I have a body, but I am more than the body. I have emotions and feelings. Sometimes there's anger, irritation, fear, sadness, joy, happiness. These emotions I experience, they come and they go. I am aware of them, but I can be at the center of transforming power, and they do not pull me back and forth. Do not lead me to violence and harm. I can manage them. I have emotions, but I am more than my emotions. I have thoughts and attitudes. They flitter across my consciousness. little voices, sometimes distracting, sometimes helpful, creative. I can be aware of my thoughts. I watch them pass. And like my emotions, they change and come and go. But I'm aware that I am at the center. I have attitudes. My attitudes can lift me up or bring me down. Myself as the center of pure self-consciousness and will that can manage my thoughts, my emotions, my body, and use them to the benefit of myself and others. The transforming power within is mine, but belongs to all others too. I can choose to be a vehicle of transforming power, radiating into the world. The center of the mandala, that is myself, many faceted, but I can find the peace at the center. In, I know I am breathing in. Breathing out, I know I am breathing out. Breathing in, I know I am breathing in. Breathing out, I know I am breathing out. I gather those things within me that can benefit the world. Breathing out, I bring them back to my physical life. I gather those things that I can bring back to benefit the world. Breathing out, I bring them into my physical reality. I'm aware of my body in the chair. I bring my consciousness back to the room. Breathing in, I'm aware that I am in the room. Breathing out, I bring my consciousness back to the room. So when you are ready, bring your consciousness back to the room. Open your eyes. if anybody found anything useful that they like to share, now's the time for it. Of course, you don't have to. What's a good thing to do is maybe later write down anything you found interesting and memorable. So often we find like gifts or something we can bring back to the world, you know, to our people. So if you have anything.
In the meditation now, or do you have to read?
Everything. But right here for the meditation, especially for the meditation, if you found anything. No, but in general, the gathering is like the same thing. We come together as a group and meditate in a way, and then we take it back out. And try to...
I'd just like to say, when I first started to do meditation in prison years ago, it didn't fly. It was too strange. Men couldn't sit quietly. It was very, made me very anxious. It's become more and more accepted. And appreciate it. Someone will say, I fell asleep. And I say, that's your body talking to you. That's okay. That's what you need to do.
Contagious CC. What was helpful for me was making that connection between the transforming power and my inner core.
So I always think that I don't have time to think about myself, my subconscious and so on, and it appears that it needs just 10 minutes meditation to think about yourself, about your feeling, about subconscious, and so about connection, your feelings to transforming power.
New experience. In Norway, we don't do like this so much. I'm so glad that I can feel that these kind of techniques are so powerful, and to connect to the ABP and the transforming power. It's like the element of hope also inside this inner journey. And so I would just thank you for taking this.
Just to add on what Nat said about having the time to think about yourself and your feelings, just the part where we have to say back to myself, I felt that really powerful, because somebody can tell me these things about how great I am, or but then to just say back to yourself, I feel that's a really powerful tool. That I can say, I am, I found that really great to say back to myself how I'm feeling.
Just behind you is the
I just find in this meeting, the international ABP meeting is so exciting and so interesting, and I keep meeting more and more people who are doing wonderful things. And I have very hard time containing myself with my joy, and then to take time to calm down and just be. It's also wonderful because it's like I'm still here. That was very profound.
So you let the One but one thought I was, because I was eager to remember everything you said to me. Because I wanted to learn it. So I don't know if there is a recipe or something like this, or this is just something you do as a training.
Well, no, I have a write-up for it. There's plenty of, the breathing meditation is based on Thich Nhat Hanh's very famous Buddhist leader, meditation leader. His book called The Blooming of the Lotus, or The Blooming Lotus. And then the other part is the Rose Meditation, is a meditation that's online. And then the other part's based on Roberto Assagioli's Psychosynthesis. And that's on, it's called a Disidentification Exercise. Of course, I have a write-up for it, so after the workshop, I usually will Google it on the Google group to everybody, so you can see it in the references. And so,
I'm going to pass around the sign-up sheet. I think your name will be enough, because I think we'll get everybody's emails. It takes forever to write your emails. It takes forever to type your emails. I plan to capture them off of the registration. I also am thinking that on the international site, inside, when you're a registered facilitator, which please everyone be, there are resources and there's rooms for forums. You can start a topic and we can go in there and share these things. And then I think you can comment, this worked well, or how about this, or whatever. So it's an underused section of the website.
I want to say this. I feel very uncomfortable working online and doing something new. So I went to the education room, the star room yesterday, and they helped me, and they said, please help me become a minister now. And I'll tell you which question to go back and push it right before you. No,
and if you recommend, go home, please, and recommend that everybody else register. It's helpful to Tino if you send him a list of your facilitators. He validates that everybody who tries to register is, in fact, a facilitator. And so he won't have to do as much work if he has a list of the people who you think might be registering.
Send to Tito? Is that what you said?
Yes. Beretta, webmaster at avp.international. Or is it groups?
avp.international.
I told Tina that it's very hard to know where those contact information, you can't see on the website who the contacts are. And so I talked to him about that. And his idea was maybe after this gathering, he would put together a group for each region. Because I think my name's on there like 3 times, and I told him, I don't know where, I don't know if it's an old address. I can't even correct my own information. So he's going to, after this gathering, put together regional group emails with the contact people and regularly send out, here are the contact people, correct the information. And so do work with your regions with Tito, and this is kind of a new development. So don't get frustrated immediately if it seems like it's not working. Work with Tito and your region on this, because
on the international website there was a people
section.
Pull down or section or something. I never saw that.
You can only see it if you're already
registered as a
registered, but I still couldn't.
Okay, good.
I'll have to go get.
Because that's the ad, that's the moment of...
We have a short thing that we're doing like this in Asia, so if there's an appropriate time and you want to see it, please.
Okay. We're definitely brainstorming what people are doing, and if there's some time there we could actually experience it, that would be wonderful. Is there anything more to say about this?
So I want to talk about sort of general things a little bit.
Okay. So... As I said, there are 4 types of meditation that they can show with MRIs do good things in your brain.
The Dalai Lama has encouraged lots of research on mental stuff and has gotten neuroscientists and educators and psychologists all together to put this information together. So the four types, we did actually did a couple of them. And when I do a guided meditation, I build all four of them in. But so the first one is your body scan. Just relax. This was the first one sort of documented with heart patients. When people had heart attacks, I'm forgetting his name, and John Kabat-Zinn, but there's another name, did research on people who had had heart attacks who began to meditate. And they could show that the body relaxation lowered blood pressure, calmed the heart, you know, that's kind of a no-brainer. There's a first basic step. The next one, or another one, is focused attention. In meditation, it's usually on your breath. And we had breathing in, I know I'm breathing in, breathing out, I know I'm breathing out. Clear the other thoughts and just focus, just be present. It's grounding, it's present here. The next one is an open awareness. That's where we were listening and the words sort of came and they went. And I have to say, sometimes I have a piece of paper if there's something I just have to write down. But let them go. And that's been shown to help with creativity. It's when we have that open awareness that different parts of our brain can spark off together. And this is little aha moments. So that's open awareness. It's also being open to the experience around us. So that's that open awareness. And the final is compassion. And we did that a little bit at the end. You know, I have my rose. That's compassion for yourself. And then we can breathe that compassion out to the world. When I do it in prison, I'll start, it's usually into a workshop or an advanced workshop, I might start with the other people in the room who have shared so deeply. And then the families who have come up and the children who have come up in the workshop. Breathing in, breathing out compassion to them. And then maybe to someone who's different for you. So that spreading, it actually helps you to see people in a new light. And it helps to build that. So those are four types. And I'm there briefly on this handout. The other things are just some ideas from when I did this as a big workshop, more or less. And the backs are answers to some brainstorms we've done. So don't really look at the back now because we're going to do our own brainstorm. When I do workshops and we have a brainstorm, I take the sheets home and I add them to a list of responses before. So things I do when I'm angry, you know, productive things I do when I'm angry. I take them home and I add them to the list I already have. After we've done the exercise, I say, I can't give you this list. We can't take pictures of this list, but here's what other workshops have said. And I mean, we have several forgiveness ones, and the men I work with really appreciate that. So don't spend too much time with that now. The other thing that's been really important to me in doing this work is the idea of journaling, making journals. And I had to fight with the prison to allow me to bring in composition books. One prison person said, we don't give gifts to inmates. But
the materials.
The chair where I am now, we can do that. At the end of each day, I have three questions. And you make them up depending on what your agenda is. And the first day, maybe it comes from the trees of violence and nonviolence. How are these present in your life? What did you learn from doing these? But like, just three sentences, three questions. It's, you know, open-ended for people to use as they want to. I would say less than half the men. All my men love getting the journals. Probably less than half actually write. Some more give some thought. You know, these are adults. I'm not, you know, there's no reason. This is for you to think about. Taking the experience out of the room and back into life is not an easy thing. And I expect that's the same in communities. There's all these things pulling us. So that's the way to do that. And again, we'll share. I didn't bring a million handouts. I have a whole list of journal entries on anger. Understanding your anger. One of my favorite gatherings is, where in your body do you first feel anger? We need to know, we need to be able to pick up on those signals before we go to the next level. So that's, you know, that's usually often a way I bring up anger in a workshop, although we've done the trees. But to bring people in there, and then in the debrief you can talk a little bit about adrenaline. And when, as soon as you feel those feelings, the blood's going to your face and your ears and your hands and your stomach and your gut. It's not going to your brain. That's not the time to be, you know, that already tells you you should say, can I get back to you on that? You know, or let's not get hot. But you have to understand that. You have to be able to reflect on it. Anger has intensity and duration and frequency. And no, just how often you get angry. How intensely you get angry. And how long you stay in. So
wait.
Only in that way, anger has intensity,
duration, and frequency.
Intensity, duration, frequency. Duration, frequency, and intensity.
Many participants and the few outside and the inside say, you know, I'm so angry. And I'll say, think back 5 years. Is it the same? Give yourself credit. Nadine, I know you do some journaling right as part of your debrief.
We've started doing a lot more journaling, but that's because after our basic, we ask people if they want to join a movement for love and conscience and nonviolence in the world. And that these workshops will help us do that. But doing that means we make a commitment to living nonviolently and peacefully and experimenting with transforming power in our lives. Mm. And any experiment needs a log. So some people like journals to write, and it really helps them to write and everything, and that, if that helps you, that's okay. But for all of us, if you're going to have an experiment, you need to have some place you're documenting what you're trying, how's it working, what you decide doesn't work, what works for you. And then we're doing companion groups when we find something we think is like really true for us, we say it to other people, they reflect it back, and then we ask for feedback, and they say, does it ring true? Does it sound right, or is it just my crazy thing in my head? And we give each other feedback on experimenting with transforming power in our personal lives. Mm. So we use the journal as kind of a log for that experiment, and then recording feedback. Recording what we find and recording the feedback we get on that. It's been really intense, actually. Mm.
So what was the name you said? Do you want to be part of a movement for
Well, I see. Do you want to practice peace and nonviolence in your life and join a movement of love and conscience? That we're creating cultures of peace. I hear that John Schufer has done that too. He's doing his community workshops, creating a culture of peace. So we're also, I don't know who started that language, but the Training for Change, the Catholic Pacha Bene, and another big international movement are starting to talk about building a culture of peace in the world. So I'm seeing it starting many places. Wow. Norway, at Oslo House, Peace House, there's a group creating a culture of peace. So, and we're talking about a people's movement for love and conscience, and experimenting with transforming power in our lives.
Are we recording, Terry?
Yeah.
We are recording.
Dot? Dot from TC. One of our facilitators, Jack Willis, who making those, started in our basic to bring journals for people to use the basic to take notes and to during the 3 days to in the evening or and then continue on after they do that. And so that's been, and so we have some time during the workshop for people to do some journaling.
Oh, I forgot to say that. The way we're using it in the workshop, not with every activity, but the main substance activities that we do, we have a way that we're processing, which is when the activity's done, we say, take your journal out and make notes for implications for yourself. Don't quickly tell other people, then you think they're done and you don't do them. If it's something you have to do, make a note for yourself so that you remember that you learned this, that you want to do it. And then get into a group of three and talk about the material. What did you learn from the activity and the material? And then come back to the whole group and ask any question you have about the material and talk about what are the implications of that activity for us as a people. And that has been an amazing question, reflecting on ourselves, but reflecting on us as a people. At first, it's people have a hard time answering. But over many workshops, we're learning to ask ourselves that question, and it's getting stronger and more interesting.
My experience in Kenya is every workshop gets an example. Do you do that so in Mombasa? And initially, every workshop you come in and you get your some example
there, example,
you know, and a pencil or a pen or something. Initially, everybody wants to write down everything that's happening, and you need to say, we have handouts, you can do that during break, whatever, you know, put those aside for now. But to do this reflection stuff in here, I mean, you already have the materials there. So
I hope this would be helpful for you.
All right?
Yeah, I'm thinking that a lot of the time, okay, Nadine said go and do it for yourself. I'm thinking that a lot of people, when they're beginning to do some work like that, won't have words, won't know what it is, won't know where to go with it, and it might be easier in pairs to start. That's why I'm just thinking that, because I know so many people who don't, they just wouldn't have the words until we start to compare them. If one person gives it, then you start to think about it. And then pairs and go right on down, then go back and I don't know, I'm just thinking that a lot of people have no words for things.
Developmental psychology says we are right where we are.
Exactly.
But we recognize whatever the next step is. And it'll click. Oh, that's a good idea.
Yeah.
Oh, I like that idea.
Yeah. Yeah.
Something up here? Maybe not so much.
Yeah.
But this sharing and recognizing, and that's one of the powers of having our groups. Outside facilitators could come in with this big bia-ba-ba-ba. We need to come in and just talk.
Yeah.
And let the participants.
And it was at one of the times I did it at a very difficult time when it was the election violence, the one day listening. And we, these kids were so angry with each other. But after we did this meditation, they were pleased that they became angry. They were pointing at me. Who is she? Like, it was a very, very new experience. But they found it very
I want to move along to a brainstorm and get down a few of the ideas here, but ideas, there are many, many ways to slow things down and take people deeper in our workshop. And I'm sure that you all have done things or recognized things, or will somebody will say something and it'll spark something new. Mark will scribe. Thank you. I don't want to go over all the things we've done and mention. People can look at that. I will start with one, and maybe we go around one at a time before we have a second chance. How many of us read the beginnings and stuff of those manuals? There's amazing information in some of those. But there's a metaphor of the jewel within us that's covered with crud and da-da-da, and we can breathe it, but the light's still there. We can breathe into it and let the crud fall away and let the... It's quite similar to this. It would be a fine metaphor to use for building in the different types of meditation. It's an easy thing to make into a meditation. So can you say jewel metaphor from the advanced?
When you say that, I just get amused, because that metaphor of the jewel wasn't really coming. So we used it.
The metaphor of the jewel didn't work.
It did not work. So we used the cooking pot. Which is shining, not hot, but
It's been cooked and has lots of
soot
on the sides. Yeah. That's an amazing African translation of that metaphor.
Yeah.
You might say this a cooking pot metaphor from your old cooking box.
Or cooking pan.
Cooking pan. So, other things that people do to...
So, are you just talking about meditation?
No, anything you do to deepen the workshop.
So, I would say one thing that I find is really helpful is small groups. Mm-hmm. Two, three or four people speaking together. So, the people who have difficulty talking in a large group then can start to open up, and that those conversations often go very, very deep.
The small group exercises, the small group conversation. I'm going to sort of eyeball around the circle as many times as we need to. Yes?
I think in Norway, when I'm facilitating anyway, my experience is the quality of the questions after each exercise can take it down. But also, when you have, for example, the wind blows, it's possible to use the wind blows and to point out the wind blows on those who have experienced this and that, and then you can carry the tension towards very specific and difficult thing, actually. But it's a little bit difficult, and you can trigger each other, so the facilitator can make sure that one of the other facilitators are standing there, and then they're open for you.
So the big wind blows for anyone who has experienced
some kind of,
Do you say that it has to be true for you?
No way, this is like, we don't practice that. This is the idea, yes, but sometimes you can go a little bit on if it is the,
Thank you.
In Tibet, there is a sense of saying we.
Says we have the seeds of both of those trees with us. Well, they're both there. Which one will you want? Let me go around and come back to you.
That's a good point, right? Because focus on violence, that becomes a bit sad work.
And the man will say, we know all this, but you created this tree in Nana. You know this. This is in you. And Terry, moving around?
I don't have the exact wording for this, but I know in American Indian culture, oftentimes adults will relate a story to a younger person about having two different animals. One is a wolf, and one is something good.
Sheep.
Yeah, and it depends on which one you feed.
So one of the things that we've started doing is, and we've actually moved this to the basic now, that when we do good listening before we talk about violence, we do a little thing where we say, I wish we had it here because it would take so short, but we just relax a minute and think of a moment you just felt totally yourself. Mm-hmm. You felt totally alive. Not a care in the world. You are clear and confident and curious and engaged and really present. Just feel that in your body, that moment that you are just yourself. And then we have oil, pastels, and paper, and draw. Mm-hmm. But start with your non-dominant hand.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
because you're just drawing a feeling. And then you can switch hands if you want, but you're just drawing a feeling. It's not the drawing, it's what it feels like. And so then we draw with both hands with really vibrant color. And then when we get done, we say, put your name on it and three words. Anywhere you want on the page in any way. And you put your three words on, and then we show each other, maybe we put them on the floor, maybe we put them on the wall. We say, this is who we are individually, and this is who we are as a group. Sometimes we're upset or distressed or confused. That's not a good time to make a decision or take an action. Let's try to come back to this before we move forward. But with the listening, we say, now we're going to be a good listener, but we're also going to be a good companion. And a good companion that can listen to things that are hard to hear or that we don't want to hear. And a good companion is somebody who's a good listener with all of that, but stays relaxed and non-anxious in my core self and remembers the core self of the other person. That you are good and capable, and you have a core self, and I remember my core self, and I am relaxed and non-anxious, and I listen from there. So that's really helped a lot. We have a core self activity for good listening and good companion. And so that's something that we can share. It's been really nice.
Petrus Peduli dari Indonesia. Jadi dari pengalaman saya untuk pelatihan apa, orang bicara itu sesuatu yang sulit. Jadi
sometimes,
tidak ada keberanian untuk bicara, apalagi di apa, di forum seperti ini.
Sometimes people have a really hard time speaking, especially in a big group for us. That's very hard.
Jadi dia harus berpikir keras untuk apa, berani bicara dan berpikir apa yang dia harus sampaikan.
He has to, the person has to think very hard on what they want to say, how to say it, and then have the courage to say it.
Sehingga ini menjadi HTK itu menjadi satu alat yang sangat membantu, karena memberikan kesempatan kepada semua orang yang berlatih untuk berani bicara dan berpikir.
So for us, AVP has become an incredibly important tool to go around and give everybody a chance to talk, but give them enough time and give them the space that they've learned that this is a place where you can practice thinking and that you can practice speaking, and that we don't rush each other in doing that, because we discover it's such a valuable thing to have the opportunity to practice that.
Yeah. Setiap selesai kegiatan kita juga melakukan debrief, dan biasanya pertanyaan-pertanyaan mulai dari merasa apa, dan juga merasa apa saat melakukan kegiatan, dan apa yang bisa dibawa pulang dari pelatihan ini.
So at the end of each activity too, this opportunity to stop, and at the end of each activity say, what did it feel like, what did I learn, and how am I going to take this home, and what am I going to do with it when I get home, and to make sure that we give enough time for that, that that's not rushed.
Biasanya untuk pembukaan hari kedua dan hari ketiga, kita biasanya menggunakan nama dan kekuatan perubahan apa yang sudah dilakukan setelah berlatih, untuk setelah pulang dan ini kembali. Dan itu biasanya banyak hal, kita mendengar perubahan-perubahan yang luar biasa yang sebelumnya tidak dialami.
Often on the second and the third day when we do a workshop, the opening question was, what did you get in the workshop yesterday that you took home and used or shared with others? And that leads to a lot of discussion for us. And that's a big focus, and again, we try not to rush that and spend a lot of time there.
Is it an opening? For an opening, what did I take away from yesterday and use, or
what did I use and how?
That helps to set the expectation, too. That you know,
but I think
not just about what happens in the room.
One of the things I'm hearing in what he's saying is that the times we do these, don't rush them. Mm-hmm. That realize if people aren't speaking, it isn't because they don't want to speak. They just need more time.
Yes, I'm thinking of one exercise that has often been getting the participants engaged into deeper soul searching and realization that we are interdependent. The exercise on empathy has been given mostly my participants at the prison an opportunity to think in a greater way how they can help one another while inside there, and it is giving them tools that they can employ even with the members of the extended families outside. So it has proven to work, because the feedback that we have been receiving has been enormously positive, and that to me has made me feel happier and happier and even more desirous of continuing with prison visits. And all of us that have worked in prisons do know that those are the most unfriendliest of places one would desire to visit. Six gates to go inside, you're treated like a prison again, but it, when this item on empathy comes up, I also personally feel that I am part of my participants' issues, real or imagined. So it helps me grow and become a better person. Thank you.
So can I try to summarize that?
Kindly.
So, to draw attention to our interconnectedness.
Yes.
And one good place to do that is the empathy exercise.
Exactly.
There are many, but you know, that interconnectedness and empathy is one place to do that. Thank you.
Thank you.
For me, it's what we try to do mainly, that I have observed, is just having a space where every individual is respected, the participants mainly. We have creating that space where, safe space. And the word that we like to use, it's a Kinyarwanda made up word, it's called agachiro, which is dignity, self-respect, all of those words. But just having that space where somebody feels it's okay to share, because in Rwanda we don't have a culture of sharing. We don't share our feelings easily, and that's partially because of the history and just the whole, I don't know, and how we're moving forward from the history itself. So when we're introducing AVP, we have to always assure people that that assurance is very important. And also respecting also respecting that some people will not really volunteer themselves to share. They're just accepting that a workshop will end up not having, we may not have the substance that we want to come out of the workshop, but it's okay.
You are so easy.
Yes. So that's very important.
So at first what I like to do, as Peter said, it's empathy exercise, because sometimes it's difficult for people to start talking about their problems because they are afraid of judgment, and so it's more easy to write on a paper anonymously and waiting empathy and not judgment. So this is the first very good exercise that I like to use. And one other exercise, as who am I? It's like meditation and to think about yourself, about your feelings.
Okay, we don't have to all go around, but I don't want to lose anything. I want to say that for gatherings or for exercises where you can be talking about things in concentric circles, I usually introduce it early and then remind it, the idea of going deep but being brief. You know, sometimes there's a big story behind something that's wonderful, but we want the depth and briefness. And then before we actually start, you know, we're going to do an exercise, a gathering such as, where in my body do I first feel anger? Stop. Give the question. And really hold some silent time for people to think about that. And also to think, you know, how to express that clearly and briefly. They may want to say, well, when I did this happened, I got mad this way, or and then I do this, or just the very core of what is this question. Deep, that's sort of deep, that idea of going deep but being brief, and then having time to really think about the question. In concentric circles, everybody has time to think about the question. So I'm not thinking about my answer while I'm trying to listen to somebody else's. You know, give everybody that time before you start. Other thoughts, ideas? I'll just go around if that's okay, but just give a wave of your hand and we'll come around.
Okay, so I'll try to be brief. So one is an insight about, you know, when you have people who kind of sit there and they don't share. And early on, it came to me that often people who don't open up and share anything think they have nothing of value to offer. And if you can find a way to connect them in and make them feel that they have something of value to offer, that that can make, that then suddenly they want to get to. And the other is what is violence in a way that we've done it. And it's not always, it kind of depends on the group, but we'll just brainstorm all of the violence. And then, and I will usually do it first so that people feel more comfortable, ask them to come up, circle an aspect of violence that has affected their life, and tell us a little bit about that, whatever that experience was. And then we do the spiral of life, and put in the spiral of life, what would be the healing or the balance that would balance out that aspect of violence. And so people really open up.
Where do we access that exercise? That's not in the manual. So where does that exercise come from? Where is that available? Okay, well, we'll write it up and we'll have an email exchange in this group. Okay. We'll grab it. Thank you. Okay.
I find myself in a no man's land where I know there's a lot to go, there's a lot to be said, but I don't know what it is. And so I find that when other people talk, it usually gives me an idea. And I've been doing ABT for years, but I'm always like the whole thing of going deep and going personal. It's like even myself, I haven't been able to do it. I find something that's acceptable, personally. And I know that now if I do it, a lot of people do the same thing. And it wasn't until I did with Nadine, like a year and a half ago, I mean, I've been doing this stuff for what, years, 10 years, 15 years, that I finally felt safe enough to share something and even admit to myself there was something that was not uncomfortable. It was so uncomfortable, I couldn't deal, I did not deal with it. So I think just making sure, just having the space and giving the time, and just knowing it's going to keep. Like I never thought about respect until we had the concentric circles, and I keep learning about respect, and I've been doing it for years. It's just something that keeps coming, and like you say, giving the space that you know you're not going to get everything you want, or the depth you're hoping for. But I don't either.
Thank you. So these two go together around the right, having the right to pass for me.
Mm-hmm.
When I introduce that guideline, I say, you know, respect that in yourself. You have the right to pass. And you choose what you want to share.
Mm-hmm.
You can't take it back once you put it out there. So respect yourself and your limits, and we all need to respect your limits. That's a very important part of it, exercise, and that helps to create that safe space. Right? We are at 12:32. Lunch starts at 12:45 or something. I propose we don't do a closing. I don't want to lose any ideas, but I don't want to hold anyone if they have a lunch meeting or need to go.
I have one idea I'd like to share before we go, but I respect people if you need to leave. One of the things that we have started doing is in the cooperative agreement, the second one we do is listen, don't interrupt. And we've started putting stop, listen, don't interrupt. And this idea of stop in your body and your mind.
Mm-hmm.
And we've made that part of good listening. So when we do good listening, stop in your body, your mind. Turn yourself towards the person. Try to follow what they're saying. Don't get ahead of them and believe them.
Mm-hmm.
And but then this idea of stopping. So often now when we come together before we do the gathering to go around, we just sit and feel, just relax. Feel your skeleton. Your skeleton's here to keep you up.
Mm-hmm.
Relax, let go of everything. Use your bones. And it's interesting, everybody wants to close their eyes and go into this meditative place, and we're saying this is not about the meditation, we might do that, this is just a minute, take a minute and stop. Whatever you're bringing in, let go of it. Stop. Come here. Breathe. Notice your breath. Notice your heartbeat. Notice the power, the transforming power that's in your breath and your heartbeat. That's always right here. Whatever we do, we need to stop first.
Mm-hmm.
And that we're going to practice this the whole time. Go on to your skeleton. Notice your heartbeat. Notice your breath. Notice the transforming power that's there. Open up to that power. Nothing we can say or do will make us any more valuable than we are right now.
Oh, that's wonderful.
This is it. This is enough. We've arrived. Everything else we're going to do for the joy of it. And so, and then once we've done that at the beginning, but do it with our eyes open, not like a, it's not a separate thing, it's part of what we do, and then we try to refer back to that throughout the day, like, remember to stop first, remember to stop first. It's the way we are, it's the place we come from.
So mention one thing, so the meditation idea, I actually developed that as part of a trauma workshop that I do. And it's, the whole purpose is to help people manage their things. So things don't go away, but you can manage them more because you're more centered and strong and confident you can deal with them. So therefore, when I do the later dealing with the trauma experience, people have a lot of good breakthroughs with it. Mm-hmm. So that's part of the reason I do that one. Mm-hmm. I start with a meditation, and we do the listening exercise with empathy. So when I do the listening exercise with empathy, when you feedback, you have to use it as first person. The other person's traumatic experience was yours. And then we go on to role-playing out. So I just think, so all the meditation, like you're saying, it gets you in a space where you can actually deal and manage things better.
Mm-hmm. And back to that space again and again. I'm a person, I'm a slave to the clock. I'm a slave that I'm the hostess of this party, and I need to really work on doing that.
And so maybe meditation can actually reset your brain. Remember, a lot of trauma is your brain actually has been triggered, overwhelmed, the parts of it's not functioning right, maybe even damaged. So your meditation really helps you to reset, maybe.
You said you have that in the education room?
He said he was going to send it.
Oh, I have to send it to you.
He has
it's
our
It's kind
names.
Of a format I made up.
So I took everyone's name. I have a couple of handouts that sort of weren't here, a little bit more of an expression of what the four meditations are, the meditation. We'll pool our things, but when I send it, it'll be to the group, and if you have anything to add, is it okay if we continue the conversation? Because, you know, is that good? Then we want to just sit for a moment. Our closing was going to be one thing I'm taking away, and that will take at least, you know, half as many minutes as we have people here, which extends it. So can we just sit for a sec and just think, get ourselves back in that body we'd like to carry with us all the time? And think about the richness of the material here. One or two of those swirling thoughts we want to commit to carry. And then can we close and just say, Namaste.
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 Thank you.
Namaste. Namaste. That was nice.